Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So we're reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 7, Chapter 2, Hiranyakashipu, King of the Demons, Text 48. Vitata binivesho yam. Did I get that right? Okay. Vitata binivesho yam. Yad guneshu artagdrigvacha. Yad gunesh varta drigvacha. Yata manorata swapna. Sarvam aindriyakam risha. Vitata binivesho yam. Yad gunesh varta drigvacha. Yata manorata swapna. Sarvam aindriyakam risha. Vitata binivesho yam. Yad gunesh varta drigvacha. Yata manorata swapna. Sarvam aindriyakam risha. Okay. Vitata. Fruitless. Abhinivesha. The conception. Ayam. This. Yat. Which. Guneshu. In the modes of material nature. Artha. As a fact. Drik vachaha. The seeing and talking of. Yata. Just as. Manorata. A mental concoction. Daydream. Swapna. A dream. Sarvam. Everything. Aindriyakam. Produced by the senses. Mrisha, false. Translation. It is fruitless to see and talk of the material modes of nature and their resultant so-called happiness and distress as if they were factual. When the mind wanders during the day and a man begins to think himself extremely important, or when he dreams at night and sees a beautiful woman enjoying with him, these are merely false dreams. Similarly, the happiness and distress caused by the material senses should be understood to be meaningless.
Do you repeat the translation? Do you repeat the translation?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay. It is fruitless to see and talk.
It is fruitless to see and talk.
Of the material modes of nature.
Of the material modes of nature.
And their resultant so-called happiness and distress.
And so-called.
As if they were factual. When the mind wanders during the day, and a man begins to think himself extremely important, or when he dreams at night and sees a beautiful woman enjoying with him, these are merely false dreams. Similarly, the happiness and distress caused by the material senses should be understood to be meaningless. Srila Prabhupada's purport. The happiness and distress derived from the activities of the material senses are not actual happiness and distress. Therefore, Bhagavad Gita speaks of happiness that is transcendental to the material conception of life. Sukham atyantikam yat tad buddhigrayam atindriyam. When our senses are purified of material contamination, they become atindriya, transcendental senses. And when the transcendental senses are engaged in the service of the master of the senses, Hrishikesh, one can derive real transcendental pleasure. Whatever distress or happiness we manufacture by mental concoction through the subtle mind has no reality, but is simply a mental concoction. One should therefore not imagine so-called happiness through mental concoction. Rather, the best course is to engage the mind in the service of the Lord, Hrishikesh, and thus feel real, blissful life. There is a Vedic statement, Apama somam amrita abuma apsarobir viharama. Viharama. With reference to such a conception, one wants to go to the heavenly planets to enjoy with the young girls there and drink somaras. Such imaginary pleasure, however, has no value. As confirmed in Bhagavad Gita, 7th chapter, 23rd verse, Antavat tu palam te sham, tad bhavati alpamedasam. Men of small intelligence worship the demigods, and their fruits are limited and temporary. Even if by fruit of activity or worship of the demigods, one is elevated to the higher planetary systems for sense enjoyment, his situation is condemned in Bhagavad Gita as antavat, perishable. The happiness one enjoys in this way is like the pleasure of embracing a young woman in a dream. For some time it may be pleasing, but actually the basic principle is false. The mental concoctions of happiness and distress in this material world are compared to dreams because of their falseness. All thoughts of obtaining happiness by using the material senses have a false background and therefore have no meaning. Om Ajnana Tamarandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurum Nilitamina Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Hare Krishna. It's very nice to be here in Sri Krishna Balaram Mandir in company of so many exalted Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis, and just asking your blessings that I could speak something for your pleasure. I'm not very, don't give class very often, so you bless me. Appreciate it. So, Hiranyakashipu, Sri Hiranyakashipu is speaking very, very nicely the Vedic philosophy. And, you know, it's kind of interesting because at the beginning of this chapter, he lays out his initial plan. He sends all his demon friends down to earth to basically destroy the Brahminical culture because he's thinking that the demigods and the Brahmins, all these things are the root of Lord Vishnu's power. And he wants to ultimately attack and kill Lord Vishnu because he's angry that Lord Vishnu took the side of the Devas and killed his brother here in Yaksha. So after meeting with all his demons and sending everybody out, go destroy the Gopas' houses and the pasturing grounds and the city gardens and the walls and, you know, just wreak havoc as much as possible on the Brahminical culture and the process of sacrifice to please the demigods and to please the Lord ultimately. But then he has a problem because his intimate relatives, the people that he personally lives with and cares about and has to deal with, they're all lamenting because Hiranyaksha was just killed. And, you know, just like we hear this saying, smashana vairagya, that actually, even when people are very materialistic, a very good time to share transcendental knowledge is the time of a funeral, because generally we're sailing through life, we have so many plans and we're executing them, and, you know, we may think we're succeeding to whatever degree. But then all of a sudden these yellow lights, these red lights flash, they go off and, right, there's an accident, someone dies, someone close to us, like that. And it's a kind of a wake-up call, right? So even someone as powerful as Hiranyakashipu, who had so many plans, and actually in terms of material success, we don't really find a lot of people, right, who had the material success of Hiranyakashipu. He's definitely at the top of the pile, right, of materially successful personalities. But even he, his brother, who he relied on very, very heavily, right, and who was so powerful that basically when Hiranyaksha was cruising around the universe looking for a fight, everybody was just retreating and sending him to somebody else because his power was so great. Right, of course, this is the Lord's pastime that these devotees, powerful devotees, they come in these positions as demons so the Lord can exercise his fighting and like that. So anyway, ultimately he was killed by the Lord, but he was a great support for Hiranyakashipu. So this was a great upset. And of course, then you have Hiranyaksha's wife and Hiranyaksha's sons and Hiranyakashipu's wife and all these intimate associates. So now, for his continued pleasure and enjoyment, he has to create a nice situation in the home. And really, what better way to pacify them than to share the Vedic philosophy? Because you can't come up with anything better, right? Like sometimes we study the different philosophers that have come in the recorded history of human life and the different great poets and bards like Shakespeare and these people. And they come up with something and sometimes it can resonate and it seems to have some value. But like the other day, I've been visiting with Gunagrai Maharaj, and he was reading from Prabodhananda Saraswati, his Vrindavan, was it Mahi, Mahamrita, like that, the glories of Vrindavan. And when you see the Vaishnav poets and the Vaishnav philosophers and thinkers, you realize nobody can even begin to hold a candle to the knowledge and the understanding and the realization and everything that's there in the Vedic. So even Hiranyakashipu, he had to use this Vedic, right? So then he's explaining so nicely. I mean, if you didn't read who was speaking, you could say it's Narada Muni maybe, or you wouldn't know. You know, when I first read the verse, I thought I better go back and see who this is, you know? And turned out it was Hiranyakashipu. But he was, when you use the Vedic knowledge, it works, right? So anyway, what he's pointing out is that, you know, everything in the material world, our so-called happiness, our distress, it's all temporary. And because of that temporary nature, it's like a dream, right? And the Purport Prabhupada uses the word false, right? And that falsity is due to its temporary nature, right? Sometimes, like the Mayavadis, they say everything's false, but then we say, no, it's not false, but it's temporary, because it's Krishna's energy, right? It doesn't stay in the same form. You can't hold on to it, but it is Krishna's eternal energy like that. So, but Hiranyakashipu is, you know, focusing on this aspect of falseness, and also in the Purport, Srila Prabhupada is bringing out that basically everybody is dreaming, right? We're all dreaming. And according to how we're situated in the three modes of material nature, we're having different kinds of dreams, right? And, you know, like there's that one verse in the 14th chapter, if I get it right, Ordvam gachanti sattvasta, madje tisthanti rajasa, jagunya guna vrittista, adho gachanti tamasa. And Lord Krishna is explaining that those who are situated in the mode of goodness, Jai Shishi Gornitai Krishna Balaram Radhashama Sundar. Those who are situated in the mode of goodness, they gradually go upwards to the higher planetary systems. And those in the mode of passion, they're working here for success in the world as we know it, like the middle planetary systems. And those who are associating with the mode of ignorance gradually go down to the hellish worlds, right? But because of the temporary nature of all these activities that we're absorbing ourselves in according to how we're associating with the modes of nature, right? These are all different types of dreams, right? And if you look at these dreams, you know, you can see we're really surrounded by it. This mode of ignorance is like, in the purport to that verse in the Bhagavad Gita, Srila Prabhupada talks about what a dangerous situation it is. It's a very, very dangerous situation. And we see nowadays, because people are so much merged in materialism and ignorance, and because, of course, the golden age of Lord Chaitanya is coming, and Srila Prabhupada's books are being distributed, and things are turning around, but still, there's 6-7 billion people, and a lot more work has to be done to really make this knowledge the most prevalent knowledge in society to guide people. So anyway, the mode of ignorance is very, very strong. And the leaders are leading people more and more into this, because in this mode of ignorance, you know, people just identify with the body and they become good consumer units, and they buy a lot of things, and they, in this way, everything's going on nicely, right? And it's becoming so bad. Like we understand that, you know, from the Bhagavad Gita, that the mode of ignorance, this dreaming state, is especially prevalent, right? One is dreaming of so many things, not necessarily accomplishing much, but having so many dreams. And if you study history, like this dreaming state, people, they even try to enhance it, like opium and opioids. You can look at different cultures throughout history. They kind of get to their zenith, and the people have extra money. They don't really know what to do, you know? I was studying once how the British got Hong Kong. It was very interesting. They had a trading post, and they were selling opium to all the nobility in the Chinese Empire. And finally, the emperor caught on and said, "You guys got to get out of here. You're drug pushers." And the British sent in their fleet, defeated the emperor, and they made a treaty. That's how they got Hong Kong for 100 years as a bastion for their drug dealing, like that. Because people get very attached to this dreaming state, and they would smoke opium like that. And this has been going on for a long, long time. Recently, I happened to hear on the news radio, they had the Surgeon General of the United States of America. This is the top medical officer appointed by the president, I believe. And this is a few months ago, and he actually came out publicly and was alerting the people. He said, "This is a great dilemma we are facing. Something like 3 million Americans are now addicted to opioids because the big drug companies in America, forget the drug dealers, forget the guys out on the street, you know, psst, kid, come over here. The big drug companies, the names that people invest in stock, you know, I don't know all their names, but like they've come out with these pain pills, and these pain pills are so effective at giving people the opioid experience of just entering into this tamasic dreaming state. You know, somebody, they were interviewing people, you know, some guy was fixing his roof and slipped and broke his leg, so they put him on painkillers. 2 years later, you know, he's running around like robbing people in the alley to get money to buy more pills. You know, it's like there's 3 million people in America that are addicted to prescription drugs, and they start out buying them, and they get so addicted they end up... So this is a very, very dangerous situation, right? The consciousness is just going down, 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 right? So then you have the dreams in the mode of passion, right? We understand that people, they want to succeed, and they're very driven, and they have passionate desires, and they're creating all the big buildings that we see in the big cities, and the big infrastructure, and the big companies, and this things that people buy stock in, and they're trying to achieve different goals, right? Very, very passionate, this dream, and it keeps people very, very busy. They're dreaming of success, and they're achieving it to different degrees, and all of a sudden, it's time to retire. They have a few more years, and they shuffle off, right? And all of the activities produce so much karma, and then where does that karma take them, right? So there's the dreaming in the mode of passion. And then as Srila Prabhupada is pointing out in the purport here, of course, through Vedic knowledge, like in the Karmakanda sections of the Vedas, they're able to take this dreaming to a much higher degree. You know, like in other words, if you really want to enjoy in this world, then there's better places to do that, right? So you can perform these Karmakanda sacrifices and pious activities, and a person can actually elevate themselves by this type of worship of the demigods. They can elevate themselves to the heavenly planets, right? And Srila Prabhupada gives a quote here. Let me just find it real quick. It's from the Vedic literature. He says, Apama somam amrita abuma apsarubir viharama. With reference to such a conception, one wants to go to the heavenly planets to enjoy with the young girls there and drink somaras. So people are very desirous of that higher grade of pleasure. And to that end, they perform these pious activities. And even they go up to heaven, right? But as Prabhupada quotes from the Bhagavad Gita here, antavat tupalam tesham, that actually this is foolish because it's temporary. That even one goes up to these places and one enjoys, and we understand that according to the level of the heavenly planet, the lifespan is a lot longer than ours, right? They may live for thousands of years, tens of thousands of years, hundreds of thousands of years, and there's so much enjoyment like that. At the same time, we also understand that, relatively speaking, it's like 100 years everywhere, isn't it? Like, it seems fantastic to us, but for them, it's kind of like 100 years, you know, everybody has this certain quota. And there's not even death as we know it, but at a certain point, is in the ninth chapter, Krishna says, Shine punye martyalokam vishalam, that when the stock of pious activities is exhausted, then martyalokam vishalam, that they fall down again. And actually my son, he was in Gurukul, not here, but in Mayapur for several years, and they were studying some Upanishadic literature, and he was actually explaining this to me. And apparently they don't tell you this in the Karmakanda section. When you're hiring these Brahmins to do these yagyas to get up there, they don't tell you this. This is what the jnanis and above the jnanis, the bhaktas know, is that when you get to the end, shine punye martyalokam, when time's up, like they don't exactly die, but they become like powerless and they fall from heaven. And as they're falling, they're greatly lamenting. It's, you know, because they've been enjoying so much. They've been there drinking the somaras and hanging out with the apsaras, and you know, the gandharvas are singing and playing and everybody's having a great time, you know, and you know, like the show is going on, you know what I mean? You don't even get tired and this and that. But then all of a sudden it's like fall, you know, and then they're like powerless and they're falling. And they're lamenting like anything, because all of a sudden, you know, their whole enjoyment is finished, you know, like there's that kind of thing. You know, people want a warning. Like I think I've heard Bhadan Ramaraj quote one story that a guy was dying, and then he gets before Yamaraj and says, why didn't you give me a warning? And Yamaraj was saying, I gave you so many warnings, you know. So, but people, they don't want the enjoyment to end, right? Everybody wants to keep enjoying. So then the last minute comes and they're falling. But as they're falling, very interesting that everyone has their allotted spheres of residence. And for the Rakshashas, one of their spheres is Antariksha, space. So these Rakshashas, they're actually living in space, and as these fallen souls are falling from heaven back to earth, they're waiting. That's part of their allotment for food. They're actually waiting. So as these guys are falling and they're very weakened and powerless and lamenting in a very, you know, forlorn state, the Rakshashas pounce on them and actually devour them. And as this is happening, it's so painful that they cry tears. Just imagine being eaten alive by a Rakshasa. And they're crying tears, and their spirit soul goes into those tears and falls to the earth. And when the soul in the water hits the earth, it nourishes a seed, and that seed grows into a grain, and that grain is eaten by a man and transformed into semina and injected into a woman, and in this way they get their next earthly body. So, you know, they went up and they had so much enjoyment. Sometimes they call it the 50-50 principle, right? You get so much enjoyment, but you can imagine that there's going to be at least an equal amount of distress. So they were enjoying like anything, but then they have these really horrible experiences. And then they're back on earth, right? And so then in this way, this dream is going, even the topmost dream, one is going to heaven. But then that's also temporary, and then it's finished, right? So we're very fortunate, because Srila Prabhupada, by giving us his purports and by translating these Vedic literatures, we're actually able to understand what is the real situation. And rather than allowing ourselves to continue in this dreaming state in different modes of nature, we can actually understand what is the real status of life, you know, what is the real goal of life, and how does one actually become happy? Because this whole thing is based on the premise that we, the living being, will become happy by following the concocted schemes of the mind, carrying them out with our senses, and the senses are interacting with matter, and according to the modes of nature we're in, we experience pleasure through that interaction with matter, right? And we've been doing this long, long time. It's become second nature, it's become habitual, right? But Srila Prabhupada is explaining that actually this is not the way that we'll become happy. And the real way that we can become happy is by being aware of what is our constitutional position, right? And Srila Prabhupada, there's that verse in the fourth canto, and Srila Prabhupada is giving the example in different ways to describe the nature of how we can actually become happy. And it says, just as one pours water on the root of the tree, and naturally all of the branches and twigs and trunk, everything is nourished. Or when one supplies food to the stomach, right? All of the indriyas, all of the senses are enlivened and enhanced, and one gets energy and one gets satisfaction. So in the same way, when we learn again to engage our senses, like Prabhupada quotes that verse, Hrishikena Hrishikesha Sevanam Bhakti Ruchate, that when we engage our senses in the service of the master of the senses, then our senses actually become purified. And by that engagement in devotional service, our consciousness becomes purified, and we can again begin to experience the real pleasure, which is the only natural pleasure that we're meant to enjoy, which is the pleasure of pleasing Krishna. And when Krishna is pleased, just like when the root is watered or when the stomach is satisfied, naturally all of the parts and parcels of the Lord, of whom we are small parts and parcels, everyone becomes pleased, right? Kind of like that pastime when Durvasa came on Duryodhana's kind of mission and showed up at the Pandavas right after Draupadi had finished her meal. Is that right? She had that benediction that until she ate, they could keep supplying. But there was some little intrigue there, and Durvasa showed up right after she had finished. And what did he have? Thousands of disciples, right? And naturally, the Yudhisthira and his brothers, the Kshatriyas, they want to serve the Brahmins, but they're... So Yudhisthira, thinking quickly, says, oh, yes, we'll love to feed you. Please go take bath and we'll get everything ready, you know? And then what to do? Of course, they're all pure devotees, right? So Draupadi is, Krishna, what to do? And then Krishna immediately comes there, right? Because he's Bhaktavatsala. He's always affectionately inclined towards his devotees. Nothing else is as important as that. So Krishna just shows up and he says, I'm hungry. What do you have? Nothing, you know, nothing. There's nothing. That's the problem. And then Krishna finds, was it one little burn? Like when you make your sabji and you get to the pot and there's that little burnt thing in the bottom. And Krishna just grabs that and eats it, right? So Krishna eats this one little morsel of burned prasadam on the bottom of the pot. And immediately, the whole universe, including Durvasa and his thousands of disciples, are like, oh, like they just ate like the 20-course Janmashtami feast, right? And all of a sudden, they're like, now we're in trouble because Yudhisthira is getting a whole feast together and we couldn't even eat one bite. So they just kind of decamped. They were afraid and they just kind of ran off and didn't show up, you know? And in this way, everything was worked. So in the same way, we are parts and parcels of Krishna, and the real happiness that we're all hankering for is that happiness that comes from within. Like Prabhupada quoted that verse from the Bhagavad Gita. Just give me one second. Sukham atyantikam yattad buddhigraya matindriyam, explaining that when the senses are purified, they become transcendental. And when with the transcendental senses are engaged in the service of Lord Krishna, then one experiences that real pleasure. So it's really a process of purifying our mind, purifying our senses. And this is the practical process of devotional service, which Srila Prabhupada and the previous acharyas and the Lord are giving us in the Srimad Bhagavatam. This is so practical because we can just engage ourselves. Srila Prabhupada has given us a program that begins at minimum, 4:30 in the morning. Of course, you get here at 4:30 and devotees are chanting and doing so many things, but actually here in Vrindavan at 4:10, we actually have the opportunity to go to Srila Prabhupada's Samadhi and offer Mangal Arti, and then it's going till, you know, 8, 9, 10 o'clock. Of course, here it's going 24/7 with the 24-hour kirtan, but Srila Prabhupada has given us this process exactly for that purpose, so that we can just engage our mind and engage our senses in the loving service of the Lord. And by doing so, then all the problems are solved, all the dreams are ended, and the opportunity to again exist in our natural state as a humble, eternal, loving servant of the Lord and ultimately experience our unique individual relationship with the Lord is being offered to us in this Hare Krishna movement. So it's a great joy. It's a great opportunity, and we're very, very fortunate. And I just want to make one last point. Here in Vrindavan, Krishna Balaram Mandir, in Mayapur, in these wonderful holy places where there's such spiritual community, at least for someone like me, when you come here, you really feel this spiritual potency, and it's much, much easier to absorb our mind and consciousness and senses and devotional service. And I'm kind of contrasting that to my life in the Western world, you know, grihastha life and raising a family. And very often, you know, we see that our lifestyle may not always match our convictions. And although, you know, every one of us, I was serving in San Diego for many years, and I remember we used to have a little program where before the Sunday feast, we'd feed the servers. And His Holiness Bhante Narayana Maharaj sometimes would ask the devotees to tell their story of how they came to Krishna consciousness. And it was so interesting to hear, because in every case, you would hear these amazing stories of how someone came to Krishna consciousness, the epiphanies they had, the realizations they had. So it takes great conviction to go from an ordinary material life to taking up this Krishna consciousness and surrendering. Sometimes later we see that because our lifestyle may get diverted from this very direct devotional service, that we struggle to live according to our convictions, and there's complacency and so many things set in. And so being in these places, you know, just really appreciating how important it is that we have this spiritual community. Like even in the West, you see some places like Los Angeles and places where it was designed so that all the devotees are living near the temple. You know, this kind of point when you can walk to the temple, right? If you can walk to the temple, how often do you go? Like 7 days a week? And if you have to drive to the temple, how often do you go? Well, maybe not as often, right? So it just seems that the more that we can create this spirit of community, you know, where we're really associating with each other and hearing and chanting together, inspiring each other, it's very, very powerful. And all of these programs that Srila Prabhupada gave us are so important, you know, just like, obviously there's no time, just like the Varnashram, there's one devotee in Mayapur now, and they're working towards that gradually. He's trying to work to develop sustainable Vaishnav communities, try to find out where our communities have not succeeded and what can be done to help them succeed, so that devotees can live together and serve together. And like Srila Prabhupada said, mold your life in such a way that we never forget Krishna, right? So that's there. And like here in Vrindavan and Mayapur, we see Gurukulas going on, and there's actually opportunities for the children who are actually, last night I was at a program and Mother Malati was saying she had been at the Gurukul last night speaking, and you know, she was sharing how, you know, Srila Prabhupada had indicated that these children are actually coming because they're devotees, and how important it is that we give them these opportunities to continue going forward in their progressive march in Krishna consciousness, individually and collectively. And if we do this, if we create these communities, and if we work together to educate the children in Krishna consciousness, then we'll see this movement growing and growing and growing in deeper and deeper ways, because you know, these are some of the things that we haven't yet fully developed as much as Srila Prabhupada envisioned. And as these communities and as these Gurukulas and as this Sangha grows, you know, we'll just see continued expansion of this loving network of Krishna consciousness that Srila Prabhupada's given us. Okay, so I better end there. Sorry for rambling on. Any comments or questions? Corrections? Hare Krishna Prabhu. I think there's a mic here if you would like to use it.
Thank you.
I think it was a devotee. Did you? Oh, maybe I'm wrong. I thought the devotee was.
No,
okay.
So, in the text, it said that you know, the happiness, the distress of the material senses is not real happiness. But you need some faith, like when a doctor tells you you can't do this, you can't do that, and then you're having faith that the doctor's giving you good advice and the medicine will work. And I think some people are promised that by performing this activity, you'll enjoy with so many young girls in the heavens, and they perform sometimes some evil activities, you know, like blowing people up,
yeah,
and like that. So, what is the harm if, I mean, how do you distinguish whether, when you're eating that feast, whether it's the spiritual senses that are being satisfied? I mean, you also see that the material senses are satisfied, so it's sometimes difficult to differentiate what is, or when you're singing and dancing in the kirtan instead of the disco club. It seems like there's a mix of material happiness and spiritual happiness combined.
Right.
I'm just trying to figure out the differentiation.
I don't know if I'm qualified to answer, but I'll try. You know, we're very, very fortunate in this process because, what is that, Kevala Nanda Khan? It's very, very joyful, right? And Lord Krishna says, because it gives direct perception of the self by realization. It is the perfection of religion. It is everlasting and is joyfully performed, right? One place Srila Prabhupada says, practically speaking, this Krishna consciousness is a process of recreation only, right? So it seems that if we try to surrender to Krishna according to the way Srila Prabhupada is, and his representatives are guiding us, that everything is just being provided in the right way, right? Just like when you put yourself in the hands of an expert, and not only an expert, but one who loves you, right? And who cares about you more than anyone, right? So this is the fortunate position we're in, is that Krishna, Srila Prabhupada, Guru, they're all guiding us out of the deepest love. And like Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, for those who engage in my devotional service, I preserve what they have and I carry what they lack. And the Lord and the spiritual master, they can see right into our hearts and really know what we need to go forward, what we lack. You know, sometimes I've heard devotees use this phrase, Krishna karma, right? That like, we're getting what appears to be reactions, but because we're trying to surrender to Krishna and Guru, that it's actually being guided personally by Krishna rather than just the reactions coming through the material nature, right? So it's being very, very carefully guided. And if we just stick closely to the process, it seems that the amount of sensual stimulation that we need, right, which is certainly a reality, right? Sometimes, I remember when I first moved into the temple, I weighed about 145 pounds, and a few months later, I weighed about 170, because, you know, you replace a lot of things with these delicious prasadam, you know, and actually, devotees were very encouraging, eat, eat. And you read in the beginning, Srila Prabhupada was personally serving the devotees, eat, eat, because prasadam is very spiritual, and it's very tasty, and it's very relishable. And although we may be relishing also in the way of our material senses, because it's purifying, that very activity is also purifying us, right? So ultimately, we can come to the stage of relishing things spiritually. So, you know, how much we get and how much is taken away, you know, it seems that the Vaishnavas are always guiding us, right? And sometimes Krishna gives a lot and then gradually pulls back so that we're kind of coming forward. Is that okay? I think it's the best I can do. Anybody else want to comment further on Panchakota Prabhu's point? Anything else? Okay, well, thank you very much. Hare Krishna. All glories to Srila Prabhupada.